Hello and welcome to a brand new edition of Smart Money. I'm Sonia Shenoy, and this week we're going to talk about all the things you need to avoid while investing in mutual funds. So we generally give you tips on what to buy, how to trade, how to invest. This time we're going to tell you what not to do as far as investing in mutual funds is concerned. We have Aarti Desikan joining us. She's our guest for the day. She's the executive director of Anand Rathi Private Wealth Management. Aarti, thank you so much for being on the show. Now, we've narrowed it down to 5 or 6 big mistakes to avoid while buying mutual funds. So let me get straight to it. What is the first mistake that people make and that they can avoid?
Thanks, Sonia, for having me here today. I think that I won't call them mistakes, but there are lots of tough decisions that people need to go through while choosing how to invest in funds. And one of the human tendencies is to look at just past returns of a scheme while deciding where to invest. What we have realized that just looking at past returns as the sole basis of choosing a fund may not be the best way to choose the kind of schemes that you want in your portfolio. So we picked up the top quartile funds, which is the top 25% of the funds in terms of performance, basis the last 3 years' performance, and then saw how they did in the following year. And what we realized was that many of those funds were not part of the top performing funds in the next year. So let me just elaborate a little bit. If you looked at 2016, out of the 14 top performing funds which were in the top quartile, only 4 of them made it to the next year's best performing funds. The results weren't too different for 2017. And on an average, there's only around 38 to 40% of the funds that actually make it to the next year's top performing funds. So the way we look at it is that instead of just looking at one parameter while choosing the schemes that you want in your portfolio, it's probably good to have a mix of both past as well as futuristic data points while selecting the schemes for your portfolio.
So if you're saying, Aarti, that you shouldn't always look at past returns, do you get enough data of what the futuristic returns will be? Because I do know for a fact that past returns are easily available across all websites, but one really doesn't have projections of what the future may look like. So then how does one distinguish?
So while there aren't too many data points for futuristic parameters that one can look at, you could look at the NAVs of the stocks in various schemes, look at what are the projected growth for each of those stocks, and then estimate what is the kind of growth that each of these schemes can have. And that's at least a good parameter to look at instead of just looking at how a scheme has done in the past.
Okay, got that. So that is the first mistake. Always looking at past returns is a mistake, and that's something that perhaps you should avoid. You should look at future projections as well. All right, let's move on to the second one. What's the other thing that people should avoid while buying mutual funds?
Okay, so I think that the first answer really spoke about how one goes about choosing schemes. The second part of any selection methodology is, once you've chosen your schemes, how should you really invest, or what proportion should you invest in each one of these schemes? And again, I think one of the mistakes people make is that I have 10 schemes, I'm just going to put 10% into each one of these schemes. Now, we have again looked at 2 baskets, one which had equal weights of 10 schemes in one basket, and the other which had allocation towards those 10 schemes basis a mathematical model construct, depending on the risk-reward ratio of each of those schemes. And what we realized was that on a 1-year, 3-year, and 5-year basis, that the mathematical model construct portfolio was able to deliver an alpha of anywhere between 0.5% annualized to 1% annualized over the previous portfolio. And in fact, interestingly, the risk of the mathematical model portfolio was lower than the other portfolio. So it wasn't that you were taking an increased amount of risk to get an increased amount of return. That is part one. But I would actually also like to say that while choosing what allocations you would like in your portfolio, first start with choosing what allocation you want to each category of funds. How much do you want in large cap? How much do you want in mid cap? So for example, start with saying that maybe you want a 60% allocation towards large cap and a 40% towards mid cap. Then choose the schemes in each of these categories. and then choose the allocation with some kind of scientific backing as to what the allocation should be in each of those schemes.
Okay, let me interrupt you here because, you know, a lot of people we know, and it's very common to find that people like to invest in 10 or 15 different mutual funds because the understanding is that if I put all my eggs in different baskets, then I'm diversifying my risk. You're saying that this is not the right strategy to deploy, right?
Yes, absolutely. And I think that just choosing 10, 15 schemes doesn't really take away the risk because some of those schemes may have the same percentage allocation to stocks or to the same sectors. So instead of that, we prefer looking at allocation a little differently. Choose which which sector or which cap you would like, depending on the valuations of each one of them, and then choose schemes basis that.
Okay, got that. So that is mistake number two, where people choose a basket of funds and invest equal amounts in all schemes, expecting them to diversify their risk, but that's not the case. At least that's what history has taught us. Let's move on to the third mistake, right? I mean, you talk about how picking diversified funds for a good alpha over the long run is a mistake. Elaborate on that.
Okay, so I think that a lot of people have, looked at alpha as looked at diversified funds not being able to deliver an alpha over the last 2 years, which is 2018 and 2019. But what we've really looked at is that if you look at data from 2011, most open-ended diversified equity funds have been able to deliver an alpha over their benchmark. In fact, the average is around 65%. And even in 2020, almost 60% of the funds were able to deliver an alpha. And in fact, in the current year, as we speak, almost 87% of the funds have been able to deliver an alpha over the Nifty. Now, other than just the Nifty, a lot of people look at how funds have delivered an alpha over their own benchmark. And since 2011, if you look at that, the average is almost 55%. And in fact, in the current year, it's almost 62%. So just investing into index funds is probably not going to be able to give you that additional alpha that you're looking at. And diversified funds seem to be doing a very, very good job in that.
Okay, so you're saying that only if you invest in index funds, it won't help. So what should the right strategy be if I want to generate alpha? And, at a time like this, when the Sensex is almost at 60,000, it's becoming harder and harder to generate alpha for your portfolio, right? What should the most prudent strategy be?
So I think the most prudent strategy, first of all, is to have an allocation, like I said, between your large cap, mid cap, and small cap, depending on the relative valuations of each of those categories. Then within those, choose schemes that have done well, look at past parameters, future parameters, and then have an allocation towards a good set of 8 to 10 schemes, which on an ongoing basis or on a 3 to 5 year basis should be able to deliver an alpha of at least 3 to 4% over the index.
Okay, got that. Let's move on to the next query then. I mean, if you had to pick out another mistake, you talk about picking thematic schemes or sector funds for high returns. Now, is that a mistake? I mean, if I look at, say, I feel like the trend now is pharmaceutical stocks and I want to invest in a pharma fund. Am I doing the right thing? Is that avoidable? What's your view?
Great. So, I think the name thematic or sectoral in itself, tells you that these are funds that do well for a short period basis a certain theme playing out. And sectoral funds are primarily cyclical in nature, and therefore the returns can tend to be inconsistent. They do very, very well during certain periods, which is mostly triggered by macroeconomic conditions, but they can also underperform the market in other periods. So what we've really looked at, Sonia, is in the last 5-6 years, we looked at two of these themes, which is infrastructure and pharma, and we've seen how they have performed. And interestingly, what we've seen is that the Nifty as an index, as well as diversified funds, have actually been able to outperform the pharma funds in every other year other than 2020. Now, I think 2020 was exceptionally good for healthcare funds because of the obvious pandemic-related demand for medicine and health products. And furthermore, I think anticipation of long-term growth based on the success of vaccines was factored into the prices of healthcare stocks. But if you remove 2020 as an outlier, what you will see is that most diversified flexicap funds have actually beaten pharma in most of the other years. Now that was pharma. Now let's look at infrastructure, right? Infrastructure is actually a sector that is marked by a lot of volatility. In fact, in 2017, it was a sector that gave stellar returns of almost 48%. But the next year, it gave you returns of a negative 19%, which was almost a fall of 67%. And in that same year, a flexicap fund was able to beat an infrastructure fund by almost 20%. So other than 2017 and 2021, actually most of the diversified funds and the flexicap funds especially, and the index have been able to beat infrastructure. So again, I think, you know, like I said, while these funds are good for a short-term period, if you are an investor looking at systematic returns and good returns for a longer-term period, I think the diversified funds would do a good enough job. And just being in sector funds could have quite a bit of risk when the sector or the theme plays out.
Okay, you chose infrastructure funds. And, you know, I mean, as a theme, as a sector, infrastructure has been very volatile. These companies, half of them are ridden with high debt. There's working capital pressure, right? So perhaps maybe that's not the best example. Maybe we should perhaps look at digital funds or, you know, emerging themes like electric vehicles, clean energy. I want to talk about all that, but I'll do one thing. I'll take a very short commercial break. I'll come back with lots more on what are the mistakes that you should avoid while investing in mutual funds. We'll be back in a bit. Welcome back to Smart Money on CNBC TV 18. Very interesting discussion with Aarti Desikan of Anand Rathi Private Wealth, where we're discussing all the mistakes that people make while investing in mutual funds and what you should avoid. Now, before the break, we spoke about how investing in thematic funds, so like an infrastructure fund or real estate fund, doesn't really give you great returns in the longer run. So it's better to invest in, say, index funds rather than a thematic fund. Aarti, you know, just I had a follow-up there. I mean, you gave a reference to how infrastructure funds and pharma funds have not done as well in the longer run as, say, an overall index fund did. But what about a time like this where digital is the big theme, where there are large themes emerging like, say, electric vehicles, clean energy, and these stocks have done pretty well? You don't suggest investing in thematic funds at a time like this?
So Sonia, I think the rationale of investing into thematic funds remains the same, whether it's pharma or infrastructure or digital. It can definitely do well and give you very, very good returns for that period. But if you are an investor who doesn't know when to get into these schemes and when to get out of these schemes, you could be caught at the wrong end of when you actually make that entry. And therefore, I think if a theme is doing well or a sector is doing well, most of the fund managers also have that expertise and that research to either invest into those funds or to increase their percentage allocation to those sectors. And therefore, a flexicap kind of a fund, which can move between sectors and move between market capitalizations, should be able to pick up on those themes if that is the flavor of the season.
Okay, got that. So that's the moot point, right? Rather invest in a flexicap fund and diversify your risk. All right, let's talk about the next mistake. What else, what is your advice to investors? What should one avoid doing while investing in mutual funds?
One more thing definitely comes to mind, which is one tends to have a lot of investments in the same fund house. And what we have seen is that people look at certain fund houses, how their funds have performed, and then tend to buy 3 to 4 schemes in the same fund house. But that may not be the right way to do it, Sonia. And what we have looked at is just, you know, 2 situations where this may not have worked out well for investors if they had chosen multiple funds from the same house. So we looked at the Axis funds. And the Axis funds had a really, really good run up in 2018 and 2019, where they were able to deliver really good alpha over the benchmark returns on all their schemes. But in a post-pandemic world, most of their schemes have really underperformed the benchmark. And in fact, with the exception of the Axis Growth Opportunities Fund, five out of six of their equity funds have really not been able to beat their benchmark. Now, on the other hand, if you look at the PGIM fund, they have had a very, very inconsistent return in the past. But if you look at the current year, their returns have been very, very good. And again, very good alphas over the benchmark. Now, if one just looks at the PGIM results next year and chooses to invest in 3 to 4 funds, we don't know how it's going to play out. And therefore, instead of just choosing one mutual fund house or one fund manager, I think diversification is not just something one should look at between large cap and mid cap or how many schemes you have, but you also need to have diversification between the fund houses that you invest into, the fund managers that you invest into. That would really reduce the overall risk that you have.
Absolutely. I take your point entirely. I mean, you need to keep some room for in case a fund manager leaves the job, in case there is any untimely demise of, any fund manager. I mean, all of those are possibilities, right? And you don't want to sort of raise your risk by investing with just one fund manager, one fund house. It's interesting, Aarti, you pointed out about Axis of funds underperforming the benchmark. Any other fund houses where you've seen a similar trend where over the past 1 to 2 years, the funds by and large have underperformed the index?
So I think there are a lot of schemes that have underperformed or done worse than the index. But what we look at is that it's not just a single scheme that we would look at and then write off a fund house or that we tell you not to invest into them. All that we are saying is that when you're looking at a particular fund house overall, certain fund managers have an expertise either to invest into large cap or into mid cap or into flexi cap. A similar fund manager may not have that expertise when they are investing into another scheme. And therefore, I don't think I would take, I don't have data on any other fund house that has a similar track record. But the point being that do not put all your eggs in one basket is, I think, the simple message.
Absolutely. Okay, we have time for just one more mistake that one can avoid. What would your last advice be to viewers right now?
So I think the last mistake is, in fact, a myth that a lot of people have, which is to invest, one needs a lot of money. So, we have had clients over the years coming and telling us that I don't have a corpus of a crore or 50 lakhs, and therefore, maybe I can't invest into the markets. And I give them a simple example, Sonia, which is that even if you did an SIP, if you had started at the age of 25, you did an SIP of just 5,000 rupees for 40 years. So therefore, you would have invested 24 lakhs over those 40 years. If you had earned a rate of return of around 12%, what that money would have grown to when you were 65 is around 5.9 crores, right? Take a second example. You didn't start investing because you didn't think you had enough money, and you started investing at the age of 50, and you put in a crore every year till you were 65. So you've put in 15 crores, which has again grown at 12%. You will have around, you would put in 15 lakhs every year. You would have had around 5.4 crores. So the basic point being that you can put in a very, very small amount. You can, in fact, invest less if you start early, and you would have a lot more because of the pure power of compounding. And so very simply, please invest, please start early, and please do not wait irrespective of what corpus of money you have, because investing is the most important part, not the quantum of investment.
Absolutely. And, that is a query we get asked very often, Aarti, about the amount that one can put in, and they feel like every amount is small. Relatively, if you compare it, anything can look small or large, right? But I take your point that retail investors are a bit hesitant sometimes. I had another question for you. Given that we are at this juncture in the market where the market has run up so much, right? This year has been a phenomenal year for the bulls. The Nifty is up 25%, mid caps are up over 35%. What do you do now as an investor? Is your recommendation to investors to continue putting in money despite where the market is, or at such a juncture where you're getting a sense that, you know, perhaps things may consolidate for a bit, is this a good time to be raising cash levels? What do you tell your clients?
I think, Sonia, before telling them what they should do today, my first question to them is how long they want to stay invested in the market and what their objective is. So if your objective is to invest today for a period of just the next 1 year or the next 2 years, I think that there could be a significant amount of risk to start investing into equity. Having said that, I think what we have all seen over the last 15, 20 years is that as long as your time period for investment is at least 5 years and above, and if you are a long-term investor, the advice is very simple. Have a good balanced asset allocation. Decide how much of money you want to put into equity, how much of money you want to put into debt or any other asset class, depending on what is your return objective that you really are looking at, what kind of risk objective are you looking at, and basis that, have the right asset allocation into equity and debt, and don't try to then time the market on whether you should invest today or whether you should invest in tomorrow. But I think if one is looking at investing today into the market, I think it would be absolutely fine as long as they have a longer term period of staying invested.
Longer term time horizon. All right. Well, these are pearls of wisdom that we know, but it's good to have a refresher time and again, right? Aarti, thanks a lot for joining us. It was a pleasure speaking with you. And it's good to sometimes tell investors what not to do, because we keep telling them what to do, but no one knows about the mistakes and how to learn from them. So I'm glad you brought all of them on board. Thank you so much for joining us, Aarti. And thank you to all our viewers for watching. Keep writing into us. We love getting feedback from you. Until we meet again, stay safe.